Today, we honor to have M.R. Rangaswami on the podcast. He started one of the first angel investments firms when he bought sandhill.com domain for $20 in 1997. In addition to being a founding father of Silicon Valley, M.R. is a passionate philanthropist. His nonprofit brings together Indian leaders to drive positive social change. M.R.'s efforts have landed him on Forbes and CRN's list of top technology executives. We talked about the benefits of acting small while growing big, how communities can be a powerful force of change, and his recent meeting with Vice President Kamala Harris over breakfast at her home. M.R., welcome to the podcast.
Hey, thanks, Chet. Thanks for having me.
Some, including myself, would say that you're one of the founding fathers of Silicon Valley, right? You started the first angel investment firm in the area, Sand Hill Road. You've obviously had a very illustrious career. What is the most surprising change you've seen over the years?
Yeah, I would say, you know, don't make me that old. I've been in Silicon Valley and the Bay Area only 40 years, four decades. Okay, so hopefully more to come.
Yeah, but for sure.
My early surprise was actually getting the URL, sandhill.com, right? The smart VCs in Silicon Valley hadn't bought it. This was 20 years ago. I picked it up for $20. And
that's awesome.
And that's going to be my exit, man. One of these days, someone's going to offer me $1 million.
That's your exit.
But the biggest surprise, Chet, between you and me, when I came in 1982, I came to Silicon Valley, okay? There were 10,000 Indians, 10,000 of us who are here, okay? Wow. Fast forward 40 years, there are 400,000 Indians.
Wow.
40 times in 40 years. Just think of the impact our community has made on the entire tech industry in the world has happened here.
It is just awesome to see the impact that that the Asian community is having, right? Very rarely do you see a startup where it does not have diversity in it, right? It's happening. And in fact, if it doesn't, you ask yourself why it doesn't. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Any company and every company has to have that diversity, whether it's an Indian American, a Chinese American, someone from any other country. That's pretty much a given these days.
Yeah, for sure. So 40 years, how have you changed personally, right? That's a chunk of time, and you've had various parts of your career, right? Maybe if you can just do some broad brush on just your 40 years and then talk about some of the changes that have happened with you personally.
Yeah, so first of all, I came in here as a naive, young person coming to Silicon Valley with absolutely no idea of what the valley was about, right? I had a comfortable job in Houston, Texas, okay? I went to see a consultant for some training, and he goes, what do you do, MR? And I said, I have an MBA. I work on computers. He says, what the heck are you doing in Houston? You better get out to Silicon Valley. It's almost like the old movie. Many people may not know the movie called The Graduate, where there's a young guy called Benjamin, and his mentor takes him aside and says, Benjamin, it's all about plastics.
Yes.
Okay, this was set in the 70s or 60s. So this guy told me Silicon Valley. It kind of felt like that moment where he was saying something profound, simple but profound. And keep in mind, in those days, there was no LinkedIn, no Facebook, no online internet, nothing. So I'm in 82, I'm sitting in Houston saying, how the hell do I go to Silicon Valley? I didn't know anybody, had no idea what it was. And that was the start of my journey. A naive young guy who says, you know, go west, right? I went to the library, had to look at all kinds of documents to find out what Silicon Valley was, and I suddenly found a list of potential employers, software company listings, right?
Wow.
You know, started typing out my resume, mailing it in U.S. mail, and lo and behold, a company calls and interviews me on the phone, flies me out to Silicon Valley, offers me a job on the spot, right? I had no idea I joined a startup. Get this. I had no idea. I said, okay, I'll take the job. I go in. The company has 25 employees. I had no idea, right? Everybody's hard charged. I was only Indian, by the way. Go in there, do stuff. Company doubles in the first year. Great. Company doubles in the second year. Even better. third year doubles again. Awesome, right? We're all celebrating. Fourth year, chapter 11. So that's why I say naive young guy going and go, oh shit, no job anymore, right?
Yeah. But that's what you learn from, right? You learn from the ups and downs. And a lot of people in the Valley would say, you know, one of the criteria for interviewing is not just your first few years where you learned how to be a professional, but also what were your failures? Because you learn a lot more from your failures than your successes.
Absolutely. A lot of learnings too. For example, this company had me lay off all the employees in my group and other groups in a region, right? And I was the only one left. And then they called me and said, you're laid off as well. So what do you think, right? When that happens, you go, wait a minute, I was helping the company close down and then they lay me off. You know, so a lot of lessons to be learned and from your failures. Absolutely.
What would you, if you had to give yourself, a younger version of yourself, some advice, like 40 years ago when you came to the Valley or 30 years ago or 20 years ago, what is the one thing you would tell them?
I'd say with startups, you know, at least 9 out of 10 fail. So go into it with enthusiasm. Yeah. But, you know, in the back of your mind, you know, you could be doing something else in a couple of years. Okay. Yeah. And that's just part of it. I mean, you've been at it. I've been at it. You know, we have had maybe 5-6 companies, but 2 or 3 of them have been complete failures. Okay. Yeah. No reason of your own, but just the way it was, right? So don't take it personally, but be prepared for failure. Don't take it personally and try again. You know, the old saying, that's something I learned because I did 2 startups. The first 2 failed. The 3rd one was a home run, but you don't know. It could have been the 5th one or the 10th one, right?
as long as you're, I've always said 3 things, which is as long as you like the problem you're solving, as long as you like the people you're doing it with, and as long as you're having fun. When those 3 equal parts come together, then it's okay. Because if it fails, it fails, right? It succeeds. But you're not there saying, I want a home run or a base hit. You're literally in there because you want to change the world,
absolutely,
right? And I feel some of that has, you know, the Valley has lost some of that because for some of us who've been doing it for a little while, there is a passion to make a dent in the universe, as Steve would say, right? Or to change the world, right? And I think as long as you can focus passionately about that, everything else makes sense and falls in place.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And I don't like this process where I see some people going for a company for 1 year, getting in a quarter of their stock, then leaving and creating a whole portfolio for themselves.
Mutual
but
fund
I wonder
strategy.
At some point, did they really give it their all in each one of their gigs?
Correct. You know? No, were they really mission-driven or not? So creating a, you know, in the same vein, creating a company is hard, but there are benefits for being small, right? What would be your advice to startups on taking advantage of their size against giants? Because it is startups are an unnatural act, right? Because that's why it takes so much energy and takes, you know, the power of the will, right? What would be your advice to them on how they should use their size?
Yeah, I mean, it's like guerrilla warfare. You know, you're small, nimble, agile. You can move around things. Here are the incumbents that are fat, dumb, and happy. And so it's a good fight to fight. I think really what we need to do as a startup is really keep that for as long as you can, right? Keep that spirit and culture for as long as you can, because one day you could be an incumbent. And that happens to a lot of companies, right? They grow up, they're successful, they slow down. Bureaucracy happens, layers of management happen, all kinds of stuff happens. The key is how long can you sustain that nimble, agile, can-do culture? It's a hard one to crack. It's easy to say, but you know, you got to look at yourself every day and say, are there more layers of management now or less layers of management? Can I really get a real feel as a founder or CEO for what's happening on the field? Or is it all filtered? Am I insulated? You got to keep questioning that all the time.
And you know what's interesting? There are 2 comments I'll make. One is, actually, it doesn't matter what the size of the company is. It doesn't matter whether it's 25, it's 500, or 10,000. You have to keep asking. You have to keep asking yourself that question, just like you said, every day. On, am I being insulated from what is happening in the bazaar, rather than by sitting in the cathedral, right? I think that's the one point. The second one is this. I was having this conversation with some other folks on the podcast, and this. It's not obvious what you should be patient about and what you should be impatient about, because it actually changes on a regular basis, right? This is the speed versus, you know, the agility versus not, right? And so would you agree with those two comments?
I do, but don't lose at the sight. You always have to be impatient, okay? Yeah. I'm always impatient. You can't. You cannot succeed by saying, okay, let it happen. I mean, correct. In our business, you got to push. Every second of the day.
Recently with the macro headwinds, right, I've been saying, what are we going to be patient about? So innovation, you have to give it some time, right? So you have to be a little bit more patient on, you know, you have 9 people involved. You're not going to get the product in 1 month, right? It's going to take its time to get there. But with the macro headwinds involved, I've been saying, let me be patient with the macro headwinds, but impatient with our execution in that environment. Right. So this is actually a gift, and try to make the changes that you want to. Right.
Absolutely. So I couldn't agree more.
I want to shift gears and talk about something that you are absolutely kicking ass on. Right. Profit is important, but people and community, right, are just as important or more important. Right. You've built a phenomenal thing with India Spora, right? Tell us a little bit about, you know, about what's going on with India Spora. Where did it start? Like, what was the origins? You know, where it is now, your recent trip to DC, you know, all that. I would love to hear a lot about it.
Absolutely. So before I get started on that, Chet, let me kind of say what ethos I brought to India Spora. You know, when I was an angel investor in 1995-96, I used to meet 2 entrepreneurs every week, look at their business plan, their PowerPoint presentations, try to help them. And over 27 years, I think I've met 5,000 plus entrepreneurs one-on-one to give them feedback and all that. And of course, I can't invest in 5,000 deals. I've only done 150 deals, so you do the math. But the other people who I didn't invest in, I would give them input, feedback, connect them with potential investors, potential customers. So really, I brought that feeling of the ethos of giving right up front, right? And in starting in diaspora, it's the same thing. It's to help others, help the community, right? And that's the spirit you have to go in with a nonprofit, especially, is what impact do you want to make? How do you want to give back? And so that's the kind of feeling I brought to diaspora. And what I'd seen with our community, the Indian American community, is we've become very successful. You know, right now we have 60 CEOs in the Fortune 500. We are 7% of the doctors, 10% of the IT workforce. We're only 1% of the population in the US, right? So we've done great things in many different areas. But really, I felt we needed to kind of translate success, which we have as a community. We earn 2.5 times what the average American earns, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? But how do we translate success to impact? That really is what India Spora is trying to achieve, is we have made money, we have created companies, created wealth, created jobs, but how do we give back? So that really is what we're all about. So the heart of India Spora is all about philanthropy and giving, bringing that Indian ethos of seva or service. How do we do that? How do we help underprivileged people? How do we help average Americans? How do we help society? So that's at the heart of India Spora. But it was a hard thing. You know, it's a great idealistic thing to have, hard thing to accomplish, because, you know, hurting Indians is like hurting cats, right? We have so many religions, so many states, so many languages. How do you bring everyone together? And that's where you have to leave your ego behind. You know, you just got to be selfless and say, okay, my ego is outside. Let's accommodate everybody, bring everyone together, right? So we brought doctors, lawyers, academics, artists, venture capitalists, CEOs, all together to be a force for good.
That's awesome.
That's at the heart of it. So it's not a, it's a relationship-based network. It's not a transactional network. There's a no-selling code of conduct. It's all about helping people, right? And
when did you when did it get started?
11 years ago. So last year we celebrated our 10th anniversary and really took stock, you know. So on the philanthropy side, for example, during COVID, our community demonstrated so much giving. In 1 month, in diaspora's community raised $15 million.
Wow.
1 month for COVID relief. Most of it went to India, but even in the US, we gave so much money to food banks. If you remember, Chet, early days, there were lines of cars at food banks in San Jose and San Francisco and Oakland and all these places. So we really gave back in a meaningful way. And that's when we saw the power of the community, is when that happened.
And so how do you measure success? Right, 10 years is a good period of time. You have, you've accomplished a lot, but on a regular basis, right? How do you measure success?
Yeah. So one of the long-term measures we have is, can we double and triple the giving of our community? So we are tracking that. You know, much like I said, we did this Chalo Give program for COVID and raised $15 million. We also formed a group called the India Philanthropy Alliance, which is a group of nonprofits that work with India. And that group now collectively raises about $200 million a year. So we track that to see, can we get that to $500 million in 10 years? You know, so we are doing things actively to foster philanthropy and giving, but track the measures of success. That's one area we work in, right? We've also spawned other organizations through in diaspora. For example, we've become much more politically active as a community, right? We have the Vice President of the United States as one of us. We have over 250 politicians and political leaders across the world who are of Indian origin, whether it's a Prime Minister of the United Kingdom or the President of Suriname or Mauritius, they're all of Indian origin. So what we want to do in every one of those areas is to track and inspire and get more people involved. So it's not just in philanthropy, it's in politics, it's in business. You know, we have now 60 CEOs in the Fortune 500. I mean, we don't look at their success, but look at the impact. Millions of jobs have been generated by CEOs like Satya Nadella and Sundar Pichai, and now more recently, Lakshman at Starbucks or Raj at FedEx. They're creating a lot of high-paying jobs, and that's to be celebrated. Not that they're CEO, but the impact they bring. So that's the kind of stuff we track.
That's awesome. So tell us a little bit about the DC trip you just made.
Oh, this was more, you know, I've known the vice president since she was the attorney of the city of San Francisco and supported her through the attorney general job that she had, the senator job she had, and more recently becoming VP. And she's been pretty close to our community. And, you know, I've known her for a long time. And the recent visit was to have breakfast in her house. It was to celebrate the Smithsonian Asian American Museum. Which is a phenomenal organization. 100 years, the Smithsonian has celebrated Asian Americans. Now the next step is Congress has approved the building of an Asian American museum on the Mall in Washington, D.C.
Awesome.
So we need, as Indian Americans, a seat at that table to build a museum that has history of the Chinese, the Japanese, the Koreans, the Vietnamese, the Indians, all coming together to celebrate the rich history, the immigrant history of the United States. And so that was the reason I was there. And it was a fantastic meeting. We met at her poolside at her house in the Naval Observatory. It was a beautiful summer day in D.C. And, you know, so it was a wonderful celebration. But the next step is to get a museum going on the Mall.
Generally, this is a five-year endeavor, two-year endeavor, just to get an idea.
The museum building is a 10-year effort, so this will benefit, Chet, your kids and mine more.
Yeah. Or grandkids, right?
Grandkids. You know,
because our kids have gotten older. So
exactly.
But that's awesome. By the way, thank you on behalf of the Indian community in general. Right, a lot of people. You know, you're very well known in the Valley, and I think you're getting to be very well known outside the Valley as well because you've had such an inclusionary approach to going off and doing this, and the work you're doing is great. For those of you that don't, you know, just check out the organization, check out MR. He does a lot of great work, and he actually, the team does a good job of posting up all the work that he's involved in. What he's talked about on this podcast is not even the tip of the surface, right? There's a lot of really, really great work that's being done. So thank you. Thank you for all the great work. I want to shift gears again, and I want to talk a little bit about looking into the future. You get a chance to meet with, you know, not just the tech folks in the Valley, but you get a chance to meet with a lot of people all over the country, all over the world, right? What do you think is the most overlooked innovation that will impact the work we do in 3 to 5 years?
Yeah, I think really, you know, the two things, right? For example, within diaspora, now we have chapters in Australia,
yeah.
UK, Singapore, UAE, Canada, and so forth, right? So this is a trick question. There are 32 million diaspora, Indian diaspora who live outside of India, right? So we have two things in common. One is we have an Indian DNA. What is the second thing that we have in common? And I won't prolong this, but the second thing is this.
Yeah.
Each one of us, 32 million people, have a cell phone, right? So I really think we haven't done enough as a society to connect people who have an affinity for certain things to each other globally, right? So really, I think really the cell phone technology, and now with AI coming on, you know, can we do something meaningful to connect these 32 million people? And that way, look at other communities as well. How do we get people in Fiji and Guyana and Suriname and UK and India to connect together in a way that has never been done before? That really, I think, is what is fascinating me as these days.
And Amar, just to be clear, this is not let's create a group in Facebook or let's get a group. This is about creating a large, because 32 million is a large data set, right? But trying to make sure it's not just a large language model, but you also have small language models so that I can talk to somebody in Australia who has an affinity and the background that I might have, exactly. Right? And that's, I think, is that a fair comment?
Absolutely. It's like someone in Suriname wants to learn something about something, and that person he's connecting or she's connecting with is in Guyana or the U.S., right? Facilitating those affinities and like-minded things that we can do and really pulling it together to help each other.
Yeah.
It's not about business.
No, that's for sure. That's awesome. We talk about mobile, we talk about social, right? But we don't talk about, you know, I think it's good for small groups, right? You can do WhatsApp groups and things like that. But when a group gets to be big enough, right, how do you create a graph and still try to make the connections so that they're somewhat personal? Because the larger the group, the less personal it gets, right? The larger the group, the more TikTok-ish it gets, right? Yeah. And I think that is a interesting challenge that has not been, no one is actually taking it on and try to see if we can solve that. Because I don't think it's not with the current approaches. It's actually, you start with a blank sheet of paper and then go at it.
Absolutely. Very different. Micro communities, but with the macro community also there, right?
Correct.
To be able to do all this has really not been cracked up. Many other things, but, you know, as I go throughout the world, one thing I find is people want to keep in touch.
Yes.
You know, but not just for business or not, you know, they want to know more, do more. Philanthropy is obviously one way to do it. You talk of education. That's another big field, right? In the U.S., for example, that 20,000 academics of Indian origin, 20,000.
Wow.
Right? And just keep see the impact they make, right? They probably teach 2 million students a year in colleges, Indian American professors, right? But can they now leverage that to teach 200 million people in India? That's a fascinating thing to also look at, is how can we get this community to do more in other places?
That's awesome example. All right, we're going to continue this for a long time, but I'm going to now get to the rapid fire stage of questions, and obviously this is brought to you by GPT. So, what's your favorite comfort food?
Favorite comfort food, idlis and dosas.
That's good.
Oh, no, I take it back. It's curd rice, yogurt rice.
Two things you'd bring to a deserted island.
Two things. A good book and a pen and paper.
That's great. Favorite Q&A from MR? So there's a Q&A you're conducting. What are the three questions that you would always like to ask the person you're interviewing?
The most interesting place you visited, the most interesting wine or alcohol you've tasted, and the third is the most interesting person you've met.
Great. Let's try to answer all three of those. What's the most interesting place you visited?
My most interesting place was on a trip to Thailand for snorkeling. We stopped off at a little island, and all it had was a small shack that was selling beer, and it had a hammock tied to two coconut trees, right? And I was lying down in it saying, this is it, man. This is the
it
most.
It doesn't get any better than this.
That was it.
What's your favorite wine or alcoholic beverage?
I mean, these days it's mezcal. I love any kind of mezcal, and I try that in any place I go.
We'll have to do that. The third question was, what was the third question? Most interesting person you've met or would like to meet.
Most interesting person I met recently was a yoga instructor who also was a great chef, a great musician, and a great tantric healer. And a great painter and a singer.
I'd never seen
someone do all of the above and do it well. And I was initially skeptical, but when I met this guy, I was like, wow, how did he pull it off?
That's awesome. Your proudest personal achievement?
Proudest personal achievement yet to be accomplished. I haven't done anything yet. There's still more to go.
That's a great answer. That is great. With that, I'd like to say thank you very much, MR. I think our audience will love this. This is one of the most different podcasts that we've had. We generally have a lot of people who are CIOs and CEOs, and you've obviously been through that. But I think the fact that we had a conversation about something so different, right, with philanthropy and your journey, I think people are going to enjoy it a lot. Thank you very much. I'm sure we'll chat with you again.
Thanks, Chet. And I hope this gives your audience some inspiration to think of something different to do in their lives and make the world a better place.
Awesome. Thanks again.